So today I'm going to be talking about Pharos, which is a website, an API, and more generally a platform that presents the data that has been collected and integrated by the Knowledge Management Center of the IDG program. So I'm going to spend a few minutes describing the motivations for collecting and integrating this type of data and then presenting it via Pharos. And then I'm going to dig into some of the features of the Pharos interface that we think enable users, especially non-computational scientists, to efficiently explore and identify useful information. So the need for the IDG arose based on a number of points raised by researchers. One of the key works was this editorial by Edwards, where he pointed out that 75% of protein research really only focuses on 10% of the genes known before the human genome was mapped. So since 2011, and even a little before that, there has been the notion that very few targets within the human proteome are being studied, and that there may be much more to it than just those that small set of targets. And this really prompted the NIH to start the Illuminating the Druggable Genome initiative. So as part of that, a pilot phase of this program was initiated, and this led to the construction of a number of experimental centers or technology development centers, which focused on developing new technology to highlight and illuminate understudied targets, but also led to the construction of the Knowledge Management Center, whose goal was to, or is to, collect all known information about human targets. When we started, now it will be about 3 years ago, we focused on a set of 1,700 or so targets representing four families that comprise the most druggable and drugged targets till date. Our colleagues at the New University of New Mexico, Mount Sinai, and University of Miami, together with colleagues from Denmark, put together a large database called the Target Central Resource Database, or TCRD, that collected information on a variety of from a variety of sources that covered a variety of aspects of protein targets. And I'll get back into that a little later on in these slides. And as a result, what we end up with is a relatively large database that integrates more than 50 different databases and other resources. And this represents the data collected by the Knowledge Management Center. Before going into the data and what it looks like when you look at it through Pharos, I wanted to comment again on one of the key outputs of the Knowledge Management Center, which is the target development level, again, how this motivates the need for a KMC and thereby Pharos. So there are a number of protein classification schemes that, that have been reported in the literature, and most of these tend to be based on structural and functional criteria. One of the key motivations for the IDG program is to shed light on understudied or unstudied targets such that they can become the focus for therapeutic development. And if that is the goal then for therapeutic development, it's useful to understand how much data there is around a target and what types of data are available for a given target, allowing us to differentiate between well-studied and understudied or unstudied targets. And the target development level developed at the University of New Mexico is one attempt to do just this. And essentially what it gives us are four categories of targets, proteins which have which are annotated with a, or annotated as a drug target, that is, there is an approved drug targeting them, are labeled as TCLIN. Proteins for which there is a potent small molecule, but not necessarily an approved drug, are called TCAM. And proteins for which the biology is better understood and for which there may be antibodies available are termed T-bio. And finally, proteins that lack antibodies, very few publications or gene RIFs, and a few other constraints are T-DARC. I won't go into the details of the, exactly what thresholds and what aspects are used to define these. These have been reported elsewhere. But the key point is that T-CLIN, targets in T-CLIN are well studied. There's a lot of literature about them. There are many tool compounds to probe them and so on. Whereas at the other end, proteins that are T-dark have very little that is known about them in terms of literature as well as published data. The aspect of published data is actually quite interesting, and we do find exceptions to the rule, which I'll come to later on. I just want to point out that while the target development level is based on a number of criteria, including PubMed abstracts, gene RIFs, antibody counts, and so on, the trends of the targets for other types of dimensions or parameters still hold. So in this figure, on the left-hand side, you see box plots of the PubMed of scores, essentially derived for different types of parameters. So you have PubMed abstracts, the gene RIFs is essentially the count of the gene RIFs, antibody count is the count of antibodies. The black box corresponds to T-dark, the blue box corresponds to T-clin, green is T-bio, and red is T-chem. And as you would expect on the left-hand side, since the TDL classifications are derived from these three parameters, they follow the expected trends. T-dark, which has very few publications about it, is obviously has a lower median value than the others, whereas T-clin, which is most studied, has the highest value. But it is interesting when we move to other parameters that weren't used to define the TDL levels, including gene ontology terms, R01 grants, patents, and the Harmonizome data availability score, which we'll come to in a little bit. And the key thing to note is that the trends that we see from PubMed abstracts, gene RIFs, and antibodies holds when we look at other orthogonal or near orthogonal parameters. And therefore, the TDL is a useful way to be, divide up the human proteome into targets that deserve more or less study. So another motivation to develop KMC and Pharos is, why should, is the question rather, why should anyone fund T-DARC? And it is taken from Tudor Appriah's group. And the point here is that each bar corresponds to a target. And on the left-hand side, you have, I think it's a date of first publication about that target. And on the right-hand side is the date of approval of a drug against a target or a phase 3 clinical trial. Key take-home point from this figure is that it takes on a median of 17 years to go from T-DARC, where very little is known, to something that actually becomes useful. And therefore, being able to shed light on targets allows us to hope that we can reduce this time from 17 years down to something smaller. And finally, one of the key motivations for collecting, integrating, and then displaying this data is what Tudor has called the causality dilemma. Are T-DARC proteins underfunded because there is no scientific interest in these proteins, or is the lack of knowledge perpetuated because there is no funding to actually study them? And it's possible, there are many possible reasons for this. One of them could be that there are very few or no molecular probes to actually probe a given understudied target. But again, this is a vicious cycle. Do lack of tools lead to a lack of interest? And then the lack of interest diminishes the chances that such tools would be funded or even studied. And what we hope is that by collecting data across for all targets in the proteome, linking that data with within themselves as well as to other data types and data resources allows us to provide researchers sufficient information that they take on these unstudied or understudied targets. So the net conclusion of this section is that there is a knowledge deficit. There's a large fraction of proteins that are poorly described, that is T-DARC, and only 10% of the proteome can actually be targeted by small molecules. More interestingly, from by looking at grant funding, 10% of NIH R01s between 2011 and 2015 essentially were awarded to study just 11 targets. And this is out of a total of nearly 8,000 targets that were funded by, across all R01s during this period. And so the net conclusion, again, is that DARC genes need funding and they need patients. And hopefully the KMC, along with Pharos, will be able to speed things up a little bit. So moving on to Pharos, which is essentially the interface to all this data that's collected by the KMC, there are four key aspects to it. One is search up here. which supports full text search with auto suggestions, very extensive indexing mechanisms. Alternatively, if you know what you're looking for, you can browse the entire collection of targets. And this browsing functionality is enhanced using filters and links. Each target has its own devoted page, which provides all the information that we know about the target in various forms. And finally, all of this is built upon a REST API, so it allows you programmatic access to the data, as well as integration of Pharos into your own workflows and pipelines. What's the current status as of March this year? We currently provide information on 20,000 targets, 15,000 diseases, and have indexed the titles and abstracts of 2.3 million publications. And finally, we have information on 4,500 drugs. This is from Drug Central, resource run by Tudor O'Prayer. On the system side, we use MySQL and Lucene on the backend. This allows us to have 191 facets or filters. The backend database is 17 GB. We have a large number of indices, a good amount of Java and Scala code. A Docker image is available for those interested in just testing the system out. It's a large download, but it is one-click install. And if you do have an urge to dig into the source code, that's also available. And I'll make all the links available at the end of the talk. So what is included in Pharos? It essentially presents the data from a variety of sources that were integrated by the University of New Mexico. And the primary focus is the protein target. However, if you do go into the website, and you will see that there are views on ligands as well as diseases. Those aren't as fully fleshed out as the target views are, and that's something we're working on. But whenever possible, targets are linked to other entities. So targets which will link to small molecules, the relevant diseases, publications, and so on. And importantly, these other entities are also interlinked. So you can go from a target to a small molecule to a disease to a publication and back to targets. Target-related data includes a wide variety of data types. These include identifiers, ontology terms, sequence information, expression information, and so on. This is just a sort of high-level summary of the data types or data sources that are included within Pharos. And if you go to the link at the bottom of this slide, you get a view of all the data sets that have been collected by New Mexico. So Pharos obviously doesn't stand on its own. It feeds on the data coming from TCRD, and this slide aims to show some of the interaction between the various groups that have been a part of this pilot phase. So we have Pharos out here, which takes in TCRD, which is the integrated database collected by the University of New Mexico. New Mexico then pulls in a number of data sources, a number of public well-known data sources, including Kemble, PDB, Keg, and so on, as well as data sources from our collaborators. An example is the Harmonizome data source from Avi Mayad. Our collaborators in Denmark provide or contribute the text mining expertise, and we pull in data from the disease and tissue database. And our colleagues from the University of Miami, who developed the drug target ontology, feed that into TCRD, and which allows us to annotate proteins using the DTO, which then gets back into Pharos, which we can then view within the interface. Finally, Pharos itself integrates a number of external widgets or tools, for example, the 10x Explorer, as well as the Harmonogram Viewer from Mount Sinai. So who is the target audience for this platform? During the design and development of this, we essentially looked at three particular groups. One is the biologist and clinical researcher who comes to a platform like this to characterize and validate novel targets and then identify small molecules or biologics that could be used to probe those targets. The second group are informatics scientists whose main goal is primarily to get their hands on the data and either mine the data itself or integrate it with their own data, possibly supporting target validation projects. And finally, given the rich data that we have regarding grants and patents and so on, the program staff or funders are another audience which can use the data collected by the KMC to explore the research landscape, and based on that, essentially set new directions for research and funding. given the three types of users, it's very clear that they would interact with this type of interface in different ways. And so at a high level, we have programmatic interaction, which would be most familiar to computational scientists, going via the API. And then we have manual interaction, that is people coming to the website to find information. Within the manual interaction mode, there are two classes of users that we've sort of come across as we've put the system together. One is a random access user who essentially maybe has an idea about a disease and would like to know what are the targets involved in that, what are the small molecules relevant to that. And for that type of user, search is the key entry point here. But on the other hand, you have a researcher whose expertise is in a certain target area or target family, and for them, they know exactly what disease or what target they're looking for. And in this case, they want to directly go to that target or the detail page of that target and access the entity information about that. And so the website provides support for both modes of interaction with a strong focus on search and enabling people to find what they're looking for, but also get suggestions into what might be relevant to what they think they're looking for. One of the key things here is about the whole platform is that while the bulk of the data displayed is simply collected and linked or interlinked via TCRD, there are certain cases where computations may be involved, and in the future we plan to include more predictive models and other types of computations. But importantly, we try and avoid computation on the fly as far as possible. Instead, we do pre-computations wherever feasible. And as a result, this converts analysis to browsing, and it allows us to maintain good performance of the system. So to support both types of users, we have a very efficient full-text search coupled to relevant auto-suggestions. So as you type in something, you will get suggestions which are grouped by disease, ligands, and targets. And if your starting point is hypothesis generation, this is a very good way to start getting links to things that you can dig into. We provide an extensive list of facets, also known as filters. And what this allows you to do is to start off, say, with a set of 20,000 targets and then construct a set of complex filtering rules to reduce it to a more manageable number. And then once you've decided on a small set of targets to look at, you can obviously go to the paid detail page for each of them and examine all the data that has been collected for them. So I just wanted to mention the different types of searches that we support. The obvious entry point is text search, where essentially you type in anything and hopefully something shows up as a result of that. These can be target names using various identifiers, disease names, small molecule names, and so on. If you're working with a set of targets from, say, a gene expression experiment or a RNAi experiment, it's useful to be able to copy in, say, the list of hits and find out what Pharos has to say at one go, and batch search does allow that. Simply pasting in the gene symbols allows you to identify the entries for all of them at one go. Sequence search is also available via Pharos, and in this case, what we've done is taken the sequence for ABLR from the Lynx Sky Native dataset and run a query looking for targets that we have with a similarity that is greater than 0.7. Importantly, I'll make the slides will be available, and these links do actually go to the live queries in Pharos, so you can test them out. And finally, we also support chemical structure search, where you can search by substructure or similarity. You can paste in a smile string or draw the structure that you're interested in. And you can see an example of a screenshot here, where all the compounds that are present within Pharos and match a given substructure are highlighted and reported here. One of the nice things or nice side effects of this is that using the various filters, on the left-hand side you can see the four default filters. It allows you to start doing enrichments on the set of hits that show up. So for example, one of the most useful things might be to look at which targets get enriched for a given scaffold or motif that the user specifies. So the search obviously is a key entry point here, and we can support multiple modes of search, ranging from text, sequence, structure, as well as batch. But once you do run a search, you can end up getting back a few thousand hits, possibly. And so summarization of that information, but also summarization of different types of information together is vital to making the interface usable and intuitive for our users. So search lets us start the exploration, but visualization is the key requirement to make this efficient and in fact enjoyable for the user. But in addition, we have limited screen real estate, especially when viewing the website on a mobile device such as a tablet. And therefore, appropriate visualizations to improve and increase the information density is very important. And it's also important to take context into account. And this is a useful feature that we'll mention, or that I'll mention in a little bit. Interactivity is obviously desirable, and in general, our motivation for putting a visualization at any point within the Pharos interface is to ensure that the user can do something with that visualization. But it is true that in many cases, the best use for a visualization is to paste it into a paper or a report or even a grant application. And therefore, wherever possible, all our visualizations are downloadable in publication quality formats. I will note that given the plethora of visualization toolkits and libraries, it's possible to have some very fancy visualizations deployed on the website, but we follow the philosophy of simple is better than fancy, as long as the information being conveyed is actually useful and actionable. And finally, while much of the visualizations are built by us within the Pharos platform, we try and avoid redoing or duplication of effort, and therefore we reuse visualization tools that are developed outside of Pharos by our other colleagues, as well as link out to them whenever relevant. So rather than going through all the different types of visualizations that are available in Pharos, I'm just going to highlight or go through a few highlights here. So on the top left, you see the visualization dashboard, which is what you see when you look at the list of targets view. And if you explore it on the website, you can click through different visualizations, which are which change according to the data type being visualized. So in this example here, the drug target ontology, which is a hierarchical data structure, gets visualized as a sunburst diagram. Importantly, these visualizations act as filters. So if you click on a specific element of the, in this case, the sunburst diagram, it will actually use the corresponding DTO term as a filter on the set of targets. And these filters can then be removed or added or joined with other filters and so on. So this goes to our philosophy of making things interactive and having things respond when the user actually works with them. Going to our point about increasing information density, we have one of the sort of workhorse views is the list of targets in a table. We list the target name, the gene, the target family, etc. However, the TCRD or the KMC contains a large amount of information about the any individual target, and obviously we can't show a table with 100 columns. So what we've done is to take the harmonizome as a proxy of all of a measure of how much data is available or knowledge is available around that target and represent that using this radar chart visualization. And what this does is it essentially compresses hundreds of columns into one column within this table. And the nice thing about these radar charts is that when targets have similar types and amounts of knowledge available about them, then the radar charts look similar. And this allows us to use our eyes to essentially scan through a table and find patterns between the data availability for targets. Apart from that, there are a variety of summary visualizations. So for example, in the target detail page, we summarize all the publications that are available in PubMed around a target using a word cloud. It works well for well-studied targets because you have lots of publications about them. Not so well for understudied targets where there are very few publications. For expression data that has tissue metadata associated with it, such as GTECs, we display or we make that data available, but then also summarize it using this homunculus visualization, which highlights the levels of expression in different organs and tissues, along with the confidence when available. this figure, the radar chart paradigm is again used in the target detail view to allow us to drill down into the different types of data available that is made available by the Harmonizome. And I'll show another example in a little bit. And so these are some of the examples of the visualizations that that we make available in Pharos. And in some cases, they enable a richer browsing experience. In other cases, they are able to collapse a lot of heterogeneous data into a simple summary visualization. I mentioned before that Pharos does integrate external tools. One example is the harmonogram that was developed by Avi Mayan's group, Mount Sinai. Their code was made available, and we were able to reuse that code to generate harmonograms. In this case, the harmonograms for all the kinases that are in the T-Clin category. As you can see, it's largely filled up and essentially stating that there is a lot of data, as one would expect. And below that, a corresponding harmonogram for all the GPCRs that are in T-dark. And now you can see much more white space, and correspondingly, there is less data about these targets, as one would expect from the T-dark classification. So this is one example where we pulled in external visualization tools and integrated them within Pharos. But another example is the TINX plot, which plots the novelty versus importance of a given target as derived from a bibliometric analysis. And we implemented a simplified version within Pharos itself. So for a given target, you can see the novelty versus importance. But then we link out to the actual TINX application developed by New Mexico, which is much fully featured. And as we go forward, what we do expect is to either include more useful, other useful visualizations within Pharos, and wherever possible, link out to external providers when feasible. One of the key requirements for a system like this is documentation. So if you are a programmer interested in API, the API is documented using Swagger. We started collecting a list of frequently asked questions, and they go up on the website. And thanks to our colleagues at New Mexico, we have a number of short videos that describe how to use different aspects of the platform. This obviously is an ongoing effort, and certainly if you do end up using Pharos and have either complaints or suggestions as to what works better, or even questions about how to do certain things, please get in touch with us, and those can be used to enhance the documentation as we go forward. One of the most common things of any website these days, especially in the e-commerce side, is a shopping cart. As you browse, you want to collect stuff that you're going to come to later. And in a system like Pharos, which is designed to essentially shed light on unstudied and understudied targets, in the context of other well-studied targets, such a functionality becomes very useful and actually a little more significant than just a shopping cart. So as you're going through, for example, if you are a researcher and you're going through Pharos looking at a certain disease area and the targets in it, it's useful to keep track of the things that you've been digging into, which could be a set of publications, diseases, as well as targets themselves. And so Pharos provides a shopping cart functionality, which we call the entity dossier. And the key motivation for this is that if you're working on a project, and Pharos does allow multiple independent dossiers which can correspond to different projects, it allows you to collect a set of material about or around your query into a self-contained dossier. The contents of the dossier can then be downloaded, so all the information that you've been browsing comes down in a single zip file. And as we go forward, one of the key goals is to have these dossiers be automatically enriched with linked items and recommendations. So in this screenshot, you can see on the left-hand side, we have a folder list or a dossier list. You have a default dossier, but in below that, there are two custom dossiers that I had created. And you can switch between them just by clicking on them. The contents of a dossier can be downloaded. Various visualization tools that operates on sets of targets are available here. And set operations allow you to merge, delete, take the intersection of multiple dossiers. So one of the key aspects or key features of the dossier at this point in the current state of development is that it's entirely defined by what the user adds to them. Currently, dossiers can be shared between users, but really, as I mentioned, our longer-term view is that the dossier will automatically be enriched with linked items. So for a given protein, if there are small molecules that are linked to it within TCRD, those will be suggested to the user to be added to the dossier, and the user can then say yes or no. And similarly, the concept of recommendations, such as you're looking at this protein, these other proteins are also related or relevant, are planned to be added to this functionality. So again, saving the user from having to track, go down every path through their search or browsing efforts. The dossiers provide context as well. So one of the visualizations that we do provide is a visualization of the harmonizome data in the form of radar charts. In this case, each axis in the circle represents a certain data type that was collected by Avi's group and within the harmonizome. And so in this example, what this radar chart highlights is the fact that certain data types, for example, I think disease perturbation, has more data than disease itself, and much more data than, say, I think, expressed gene here. So the shape of this radar chart essentially characterizes the different types of data that are available for this target, as well as the amounts of data available for it. Importantly, we can overlay these radar charts from other different groups of targets. So for example, we could take the averaged values across all TDOT targets and overlay it on the data availability for this specific target. And similarly, the dossiers allow you to do that based on the targets that you've placed in those dossiers. And this is how the dossier plays into the concept of providing context as you browse the contents of the KMC or TCRD. In the next few minutes, I'm going to talk a little bit about how we started out using the harmonizome data to essentially score targets and then look at similarities between targets. And the harmonizome represents the data available around a given target. And essentially what it does is to compute the number of associations for each gene in a data source and convert this to an empirical cumulative distribution function. So these are all pre-computed and stored in TCRD, and this data is used by the harmonogram and the radar chart visualizations. But for each for a given target, the data is essentially a vector of real values, where each element of that vector corresponds to a certain data type. And so to simplify this and generate a single number that characterizes the data or knowledge available around a target, we compute the sum of these ECDF values. And this is what we term as the knowledge availability score. So the knowledge availability score is distributed as shown here. Importantly, this slide and the next few only operate on the 1,700 or so targets that we started out with at the beginning of the project. However, the results, again, still hold within that small subset. And as we go forward and look at the whole proteome, these will be updated. So I've already described the radar chart visualizations of the harmonizome data. And as I mentioned before, one of the key roles of this visualization is to be able to reuse our visual system to essentially browse or glance down a list of targets and see which targets have similar types and amounts of data amongst them. When we compute the knowledge availability score, we can then compare it to a variety of other metrics that have been calculated as part of TCRD. So in this case, we have the knowledge availability score on the x-axis and different parameters on the y-axis. In the left-hand side, this is the Jensen PubMed score. PubMed count is the number of papers published about a target. And the patent count is the number of patents associated with a target. And the points are colored by their TDL levels. And as you would expect, the knowledge availability score correlates relatively well. Apparently, it correlates the best with the number of publications, the PubMed count in the middle here, and much more noisier for the PubMed score, and a relatively poor correlation with patents. As you would expect, the correlations for the TDARC subset are noisier. And as we started looking at this data, it turns out that what we would should be interested in are the targets with the higher values of knowledge availability, but smaller values of another metric, let's say PubMed count or PubMed score. And it turns out that when we looked at the Jensen PubMed score, which is derived from text mining PubMed abstracts, we find cases where there is a relatively high knowledge availability score, shown right down here, but very low scores on the PubMed score. And this becomes interesting because what it's telling us is that there's a lot of data out there about this target, but not a whole lot of literature talking about this target. So at the time we ran this calculation, there were 114 unique data sources in the Harmonizome, and therefore, rather than compressing everything into a single knowledge score, we worked with 114 element vector. And in this case, when a source had no data for the target, we set its value to zero, which is not necessarily the truth or even the best choice because it's actually missing data. But for the purposes of exploring this concept, it sufficed. I will also point out that each element of this vector was uniformly weighted, which may not be appropriate when calculating similarities or distances. But for now, we went with uniform weighting. What this gives us or allows us to do is to compute a pairwise Euclidean distance matrix or a cosine similarity matrix for, in this case, a little more than 1,700 targets. And I'll just show the similarity matrix that we computed in what we're calling knowledge space. And you can see that there is an expected clustering. The TDARC targets shown here tend to cluster together. And then there's a sort of weak clustering that includes T-bio, T-chem, as well as T-clin. So this is, it's interesting that we do see some clustering, and this could be the starting point for further investigations. but in particular, what we wanted to look at was, are there T-dark targets that have a knowledge profile that is most similar to targets that are not T-dark, in particular T-chem or T-bio, sorry, T-clin or T-chem or T-bio. And it turns out that there are 44 such targets. And within this set of 44, it turns out that 10 of those targets have a knowledge profile that is most similar to a T-chem or a T-clin target. And this becomes interesting because, again, T-clin and T-chem are well studied, and T-dark are not well studied. Yet the data about that is available around them that constitutes their knowledge profile is apparently similar. And this table here essentially summarizes these results, where you have the T-dark targets on the y-axis labels, and each column represents the most similar targets that that was computed for them. And you'll see that the most similar target for most of these T-dark targets happen to be T-bio, and there are a few which are T1, which is a T-clin, and the remainder are T-chem. So this is actually a very initial investigation, and we're currently working on expanding this. This type of similarity computation allows us to support recommendations. So if a user selects a target for addition to their dossier, we can then automatically suggest other similar targets depending on the dimensions that we look at. And one of our key activities right now is to extend this concept to what we're calling the target knowledge vector approach, which I'll explain in a second. But what might these results suggest? So publications are obviously one way to prioritize targets. Stuff that is well studied gets less attention, stuff that is not as well studied receives more attention. But at the same time, we need to consider how much data is available around a target, which guides the allocation of experimental resources. But it turns out that there, in many cases, that for a given target, a lot of the data and types of data that are reported for that target may be subsumed into a small set of publications. So for example, one paper might be very extensive and include RNA-seq, genomic data, pharmacological data, and so on. And at the same time, publications can lag data. The data gets generated, it's very complex and large, and therefore it takes time for publications to start reporting on that data. And so taken together, one possibility is that targets that have a relatively higher knowledge availability value but have a low publication-based score could be rising stars. That is, the data has been generated, people are looking at it, but the general community still doesn't really know about it because there aren't enough publications about it. So these conclusions and these results are based on just 1,700 targets and only looking at 114 data sources or 114 element vectors from the Harmonizome. And what we're currently working on is to generalize this to all of the data that is contained within Pharos. And this is based on a sparse vector representation. We have computed this vectorial representation and computed similarity matrices across all 20,000 targets. And now in this approach, a target is a document mixture of discrete and continuous variable descriptors, which could include acid values and terms, amino acid sequence lengths, individual AA residue profiles, counts of related publications, counts of ligands, and so on. And using the facet values from the Lucene index, we can compute something that is very similar to DDIDF scores, which allows us to weight items by popularity. So given this sparse vector, we can then compute similarity between any two targets using the generalized Tanimoto method. At this point, I won't go into any more details about this because it's ongoing work, and as I mentioned, we've computed the 20K by 20K similarity matrix, and we'll start to dig into it as we go forward. And our plan is to make target knowledge vectors the basis of recommendations, prioritizations, and related features within Pharos. I will end quickly by just mentioning our outreach and dissemination activities. We give webinars such as this one and presentations at various conferences, documentations including help pages, frequently asked questions. User feedback is a key, is something that we value and find very important. We have visited collaborating institutions who've been involved with Pharos, got feedback from a variety of users. And any feedback, whether it's by visiting them or by email, is much appreciated. And obviously, deployment. We've tested out Pharos at being deployed on Amazon. We have an instance running up there. Source code is available from Git, our local Git repository, with instructions on installing. And as I mentioned, we have a Docker image that is available that allows people to do a one-click install. Again, towards going to looking at innovative ways to do dissemination, one of the nice things that we were able to quickly put together is a set of a semi-automated tweet or Twitter robot for Pharos. So Pharos does have a Twitter account, IDG_Pharos. And what we've set up is a daily script that queries PubMed for the publications in the last 1 day from a certain set of whitelisted journals. The abstracts and title from those publications are then examined by a natural or named entity recognition API developed by our collaborators in Denmark. And essentially what it does is it identifies abstracts that contain either a disease or a gene target symbol that Pharos has an entry for. And based on that, it then constructs a set of messages that is sent to our Slack account, from which a human, usually me, then examines that list of publications and the targets identified and constructs a tweet that goes out to the Twitter account. Ideally, somewhere in the near-term or long-term future, we would really have sophisticated natural language processing and generation, which would essentially automate the list to tweet construction and thereby send automatic tweets out. The last two slides are just about Pharos usage. Over the last year, we've generally had increasing usage as viewed by users, page views, as well as sessions, more than 90,000 or just under 90,000 page views. Pharos is all the target pages are indexed or have been submitted to indexing to Google for indexing. And while if you search for asthma, you may not get Pharos as the top hit, prefixing anything with Pharos usually does take you to the relevant page on Pharos. And it does also include hits in partner-based databases such as Keg and Gamble, because they also link back to Pharos. So the long-term vision here is to essentially make Pharos a platform that is able to incorporate dependencies between data types and support inference and sophisticated filters, that is, go beyond simply clicking on or manually constructing individual filters. And right now, Pharos is a presentation platform, primarily. It essentially sucks in data from TCRD and then presents it in a variety of ways that we think are useful. But really, our long-term goal here is to be able to do summarization. So use explicit links and computational inference to generate semi-natural language summaries using all the data that's known about a target or a set of targets, and which we would imagine would be influenced by the user's query. And the net result of this is that we hope that Pharos will end up as a biological dashboard that is customized for the user and for the query. I'll end here with a request of feedback. If you haven't used it before, please do take a look at it, try it, break it, let us know what works, what doesn't. And if you have specific use cases that you're interested in, is there sufficient data and data types that help you answer that use case? And if not, what types of data would you want? We've published recently a description of the website, Nucleic Acids Research. And out here, there's a set of links. The first one is the website itself. The spotlight is our GitHub repository. This is the link to the Docker image. And finally, any mail can be sent to pharos@nih.gov. And our Twitter account is out here. And I'll end with acknowledgments to all my colleagues at NCATS who have really done the bulk of the work here, as well as our colleagues at New Mexico, Mount Sinai, and the Finkbeiner and Tomita labs for very useful feedback, as well as Adepila and colleague and Christine Colvis for useful feedback while developing this. And thank you for your attention.
Yeah, so I have a question about for the future features. Have you thought of also having like network type of visualization? So there's, for example, there is PPI data, protein interaction data, right, and also the Harmonizome data and other data sets can be converted to what we call functional association networks.
Yeah.
So you can potentially also consider that.
Absolutely. Network visualization has been raised a number of times, and given that, I mean, we have PPI data which is shown explicitly, so it would be natural for that to be shown in a network, and that's our near-term plan.
So this was pretty impressive. I have a question, like what would you suggest for people that want to include the backend data, right, and maybe for in their pipelines? Should we use your APIs from web server, install our own Pharos, or should we go back to the database, right, where you are actually getting the backend?
I think it depends on the type, on your aim and sort of the scope of the aim. If you're planning to integrate the data with, say, your own data sets, then it may be useful to simply download the backend database and then work with it. There are links on the Pharos about and help pages that take you to that New Mexico. But on the other hand, if you're using like specific data types, say you just want access to phenotypic information or just expression information, in that case, downloading the whole database, learning the schema is probably overkill. And then in that case, going by the API is probably more useful, because the API will also always have the latest version of the data.
So do you have like a redirection APIs that somebody can maybe link, say, another resource to your resource, right? For example, right, if somebody interacts with another web web resource to find a drug or find a chemical or find some item that you also then kind of redirect the to?
Oh, absolutely. So, and it actually goes both ways. So, for example, if you're looking at small molecules, we redirect into Kembl from Pharos, but also Keg now redirects their small molecules back to Pharos. They provide a link for us. And every molecule, small molecule or target or disease has a unique link within Pharos. So if you are developing a resource, for example, and you're referring to targets, say, by UniProt IDs, you can construct a Pharos link using that UniProt ID, which will then link back into Pharos.
Okay, it doesn't seem like anybody's chiming in. So thank you very much for this great presentation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for chiming in. Bye.